listeners, let me tell you about a company you may not have heard of, Smart Labels. The company is making inventory management simple and very affordable for small business owners. Here's how it works. You buy the Smart Labels QR code stickers on Amazon. When the stickers arrive, just slap one on a container or shelf, download the Smart Labels app on your mobile device, scan the code, and the app creates a digital container for you. Write down all the information about the items you are cataloging and take a picture. You'll have all your inventory easily searchable in the palm of your hand. Sticker packs cost $16 and the subscription is only $30 per year. Get your Smart Label stickers on Amazon today.
Are you ready for a reboot? Welcome to the Sheila Mac Show, reality at its finest. History reminds us those hit hardest often become the change makers. This year, we've all hit crazy economic, social, and emotional rock bottoms. We all get knocked down. Something hits globally, locally, personally. It affects our health, finances, our relationships. We have to recreate a business or career. Each show, Sheila and her special guest will be sharing their reboot stories, guiding you with real solutions to upgrade and up-level emotionally, mentally, physically, spiritually, and financially. Here on NBC's KCAA Radio. If you're ready to pull yourself up by the bootstraps and bra straps, enjoy a listen. Here's Sheila.
Welcome to the Sheila Mac Show, reality at its finest. Here we have real people sharing real stories and actionable steps to help you reinvent, rebuild, and reboot your business and personal life on your terms. I'm your host, Sheila Mac, and today we have special guest Trey Kelley. Now, he just started his podcast show a few weeks ago. It's a dynamic podcast that features a book passage reading, review episode, a content episode where he talks about things he's feeling, particularly what he's passionate about at the time, which includes politics, sports, movies, and anything else, and an interview episode where he interviews anyone who his audience might find interesting or influential. He is 21 years old and from a small town in northwest of Atlanta, Georgia, where his dad is the mayor, successful entrepreneur, and bishop for the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, and he also served as a missionary for the same church for 2 years in Utah and Ecuador. So welcome to the show, Trey.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm glad to be here.
All right. And I like to start off each episode by asking if you can share with the audience about a time in your business or personal life where you experienced a tough situation and how you got back on track.
That's a really great question. We all have so many experiences like that in our life, I believe. Some of my hardest moments during my life were it was during this 2-year mission trip that I served. That I told you about. I was in, especially when I was in a foreign country, this was extremely difficult adjusting to the language, to the culture, to food, everything. And something that it really affected was my mental health. It was really hard for me to stay focused and stay motivated. And I started to feel anxious and depressed. But what really got me through that was reaching out to people around me. I think too many times we try to do things alone, but there's a lot of people around us that are willing to help. And so we just have to overcome our pride. I know I had a lot of pride. I didn't want to reach out to people, but when I finally just put away my pride, reached out, and I was able to get so much support and so much help, and then just having they helped me to start having small wins. And if you have small daily wins and you keep building those up, then that will get you back on track. That will get you motivated, energetic, happy faster than anything else.
So true. Very, very true. Wow, that's incredible. So what led you to start your show?
I've been motivated by a lot of the great podcasters out there that I've listened to, and I love the ideas that they share, and I feel like I have a lot of ideas of my own that I hope could be beneficial to the world, and that I'd love to get out there and grow an audience. Even if the audience isn't huge, I'd love to have an audience where people find insight in the things that I have to say.
Yes, that's great. Very important. So what was it like doing the missionary trips? I'd love to hear about that.
Yeah, it was an adventure for sure. Like I said, there was hard times, but there was also some of the greatest times I've ever had. It was probably the two hardest years of my life and the two best years of my life as well, which can sound kind of contradictory, but it's true. The most powerful thing that happened to me was seeing change in others, because that's the point of these trips that we go on, is we want to bring the gospel of Jesus Christ to people around the world, anybody and everybody, because I truly believe that the gospel of Jesus Christ can transform people. And I saw it happen before my eyes. And that was, for me, the most powerful experience I could have had, especially as a young man. I started at the age of 18 and I got back when I was 20.
That's so interesting. So for those listening in, I think it's so incredible to learn about different faith and religious practices. And so from your church, would you share a little bit about the representation of your missionary trip and how that is connected with your, stepping into adulthood, how that kind of works? I don't know much about it myself.
Like how... so
learn. Yeah.
Like basically like how serving this mission helps prepare us for our future in life.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I truly believe that this 2-year mission trip is like 10 years of life experience packed into 2 years. And because when we go out there, I mean, I was a teenager. I was 18 years old, never lived outside of home, never done much of anything on my own before. And suddenly I have to live on my own, provide for myself. I'm not completely on my own. Missionaries for our church, we go out 2 by 2, so we have a companion with us that we live with. That was something to deal with as well, just learning how to live with another person that you've never met. And every 6 weeks we change who our companion is. And so, incredible experience. I also had the opportunity to become a leader of other missionaries, to be able to serve and help in that capacity. It taught me so much more than I think I could have learned in any other way going about my life. I think that I learned more there than I would have in college if I had taken those 2 years and been in college instead, which I am in college now. I think college is great.
Yeah. But
I think that was the best way to start off my adulthood.
I love that. That is so great. And that's really interesting. I totally believe that there's something about getting to know people outside in the whole world through travel and sharing and learning about other cultures is so incredible. And what a wonderful experience. Now, for myself, 6 children, I adopted 3 and 3 of my own. And so this really big family. And my youngest 2, my son actually had a heart condition from 5th grade on. And so when we got into the high school years, we decided to do like a home study program and travel, because he was only given like a year in 5th grade and he lived to be 22. And so we traveled together as a family and we got to see the world and we did a lot of spiritual studies and got to visit, Holy Land, and we went to India. We studied with so many different people and learned the different cultures from all over the world. And we kind of had a blast, and it's like it just really changed our way of looking at the world and connecting with different people. A lot of gratitude came in to what we have here in the United States. Even if you're on a budget, we're doing better than like most of the people in the world overall. So it just changes perspective so much. So I think that's an incredible thing to have as part of your faith practice, to be able to go out and then share your faith with others as well. And so that's pretty cool. And now, what is it like having a dad who's the mayor?
It's a really cool experience. it opens me up to a lot of amazing opportunities, to be able to see him in action, to be able to meet some of the people that he meets. I mean, it's a really small town. It's not like he's the mayor of Atlanta or anything like that, but it's awesome to see him be able to lead the city and to really be engaged in as a citizen, engaged in politics, trying to better the community. That this world, or this country especially, really needs right now is people engaging in politics. And it forever, politics has been such a taboo thing. Like, you don't talk about politics, you don't talk about religion.
Wow, and we are doing both today. Watch out, everyone.
Yeah, and that's great. I love that.
We have no fear.
You've got to talk about these things.
Yeah, exactly. It is. It's very important. And, oh gosh, what I found with my studies and travels is that when you understand a culture and their belief system and their religious practices and how everything is connected, it really, you understand the people more and you can connect with them. You can do business with people better when you understand where they're coming from all aspects. So if you leave out big
so parts, powerful.
Yeah, of who they are or what their beliefs, their values are, then you're missing part of the person and how to connect with them.
Yeah.
So it's really important. And, you know, I adopted 3 children, right? So I had children coming in from very different, a variety of different belief systems and backgrounds that we had to, you know, all agree upon certain things. And so it was really interesting. And there was a belief that I had was that the 3 children that I fostered to adopt. And I really believed that was like kind of like a God contract, like a soul contract, like they were supposed to be in the family and in that period of time. And that they had to have their original experiences first. And that was part of what they needed in their life to become, they're all serving. One is in the Army, you know, I have all these Navy and Marines.
That's incredible.
Not at all. And so that, and they're traveling the world and really representing our country now. So it's kind of cool. But that was a big thing. And to really listen to what they brought and their experiences and hear their stories really helped my children to have a lot of gratitude for things. So we also grew up, they grew up in our home, which was very political. And I'm going to be very honest, it was nonpartisan primarily. So I worked a lot with many campaigns for equal education for all, to help children to have really good fair quality education in the U.S. And so that was something I worked really hard on. And my children grew up with helping me. Back then, we used to print the flyers and they would come into the campaign offices. We met all the mayors. We met a lot of people in politics and we had a blast because it was really to help children. And so they were involved in that process. They weren't like left aside, and being part of what we did, because it was helping kids and this and that, it really taught them a lot about politics and people, and just that was another cool experience that we didn't hide from the children. So they had fun. They have the best memories and everybody just loved them. We'd, you know, get the flyers out. We got to ride on the bus with all the people and do a campaign. We did a documentary about school choice that was filmed at USC. We had a blast. So, you know, if you're listening in and you're a parent, whatever your, you know, bring your children in, you know, to whatever your spiritual practice is, of course, and then whatever your belief and value system is, so that they understand and they become really great citizens later on because they're involved and they can speak wisely about whatever the topic is because they've experienced it. Now, what are some of the shows? You've had a few shows already. Can you tell me like a little example about what the shows were like? What did you talk about so far on your podcast?
Yeah, for sure. I've had a couple shows come out now, and one's in the works right now. But my first episode, I first talked about, of course, in politics in America right now, it's really starting to ramp up. We got the 2024 elections coming, and I talked about everything that's going on, especially in the Republican Party with Ron DeSantis and finally entering the presidential race, which was a big move that a lot of people expected. I talked about that and who I thought was the better candidate between DeSantis and Trump. And then I went into talking about sports. A huge debate in the sports world is who's the greatest between Michael Jordan and LeBron James. And I had to take on that debate and show to the world how Michael Jordan is the greatest. And then finally for that episode, I talked about not too long ago, I think it was a few weeks ago, I don't know if you heard about it, there was a 60 Minutes episode on my church, the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, talking about our finances and how there was a whistleblower and some controversial things came out. And I talked about my thoughts on that and the whole legal process on it and everything. So that was my first episode. And then I did have an episode about a book reading where we read passages from How to Win Friends and Influence People by Dale Carnegie,
yeah. Yeah.
Which I believe is possibly the greatest self-help book of all time. Another episode coming out, it should come out on Monday, about we discussed Andrew Tate and what our thoughts are on him because he's a really big controversial figure in the media right now. Andrew Tate is some multimillionaire, maybe billionaire. I don't know. He's a really rich guy who's gotten really famous recently for going on podcasts, and he talks about basically about masculinity, what it means to be a man, and what masculinity should be about. I think he's got a lot of really good views, things that have been attacked by society, but when it comes to masculinity, that shouldn't be, that should actually be promoted and brought out because it creates stronger men and stronger societies. But he's also, he's a very worldly, prideful man who his biggest focuses in life is having a lot of money, having big houses, cars, and getting with a lot of women. And I don't think that's, I don't think that's what manhood is about. And I think that he does get things wrong a lot.
Well, there are people that still are figuring things out in that realm.
Yeah.
I'll just say it that way. Some podcasts about masculinity and femininity and how that shows up in the world and in each of us. And it, you know, I think that there's, in each relationship, there's definitely the qualities. And if you have whatever the relationship looks like, if two people are really masculine, it's not going to work out if they're both in their masculine.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of women today are in their masculine and not very feminine.
Right,
and a lot of men, and it's like, okay, there's a balance, and we all have kind of both in us in our own way. There's times where you're softer, mm-hmm. because you need to be, even as a guy, like you're going to be a dad one day. You're going to be softer with your children. You're going to be loving in a certain way. And so it really is important because a lot of us, there's been a lot of loss in that area of figuring that out.
Yeah.
and it's individual.
Yeah, 100%.
Yeah. And everybody's got to do that for themselves, whatever works for them. But it is really an important thing. I mean, I definitely think there's nothing nicer than, well, a masculine man to me, the first thing I think of is that I feel really safe. Right. They make me feel safe. I know I'm okay. I don't, and then I can be really feminine. I don't have to defend myself because they're going to do that. They're like, I got this. And they mean it. And so that's like, yeah. Sign me up for the masculine man. That's awesome. And so that, you know, and there is, and if you're not feeling safe with a man, then he's probably, or somebody that's in the masculine realm in a relationship, you're not going to feel safe. And if you don't feel safe mm-hmm. in a relationship, you can't have a relationship. You know, and I think it goes both ways, because the man has to feel safe in his own way that you know, you're an honorable woman that's going to be in a good relationship. And so there's a lot. And I think that's the values. Your values have to be aligned when you're getting into a relationship, which may be the next step in your life. It's really important. It's like the biggest decision you'll make. And if you're not aligned in your values, how you're going to live, how you're going to have your faith, how you raise your family, then it's not going to be a good relationship. It's going to be very confusing for children. And so whatever that conversation is, and however you decide when you're dating or getting into marriage or considering whatever that looks like in a relationship for you, that's really important to be on that same page and know. Yeah.
Yeah, I loved how you said all that.
Oh, thank you.
It was perfectly said. I watch a lot of Jordan B. Peterson, and have you heard of him? Great.
Don't tell Jordan. I have to look all these people up.
Heard of him either?
No.
But no, yeah, he's one of the most famous psychologists right now, and he shares pretty much the exact same views, same way you worded it. So I really love how you said that. Yeah,
now I'm gonna have to really look him up, because we agree. That's cool. That is great. Yes, so that's wonderful though. And it's so nice, because you're very young still, even though you might not feel that young, you're enjoy that young time. It goes quick. What was that like for you, going through, you went through like high school and COVID?
So COVID, actually, COVID actually started right after. So I graduated in 2019. So COVID started in 2020.
So
I started my mission trip during COVID. Yeah.
So you were really guided to go, and even through the pandemic, that was pretty brave. Were there some people that put off their
mission? Yeah, a lot of people actually put off their mission trips for that.
Wow, that is interesting. Yeah. So what was your decision that was like, I'm going to go anyway?
Well, I've always known that I was going to go. Since I was a young kid, I've had dreams of going on a mission. And so when the time came, I wanted to go. I wanted to do it. And they gave me the option. Church headquarters sent me an email and asked me, do you want to postpone for 18 months or you can just go now? And I said, let's go now, because I knew I wanted to do it, and so I didn't want to wait any longer.
Right. Wow. That's incredible. Well, that's wonderful that you did that. And you had some, what was like the hardest experience you had during that missionary trip or trips?
Definitely during that time when I was feeling just really overwhelmed by being in Ecuador, being in a different country, and I was having a lot of struggles mentally. And then I got there's a kind of an infamous disease down there called dengue that comes from the mosquitoes.
Right.
And so just during that time, like my worst mental state, I got dengue, and it's just a terrible physical state as well, because it's a really painful disease. Like, it's this fever that you get that's really painful. The nickname for it is called breakbone fever, I think.
Wow.
And so I was just out. I was just stuck in bed for like a week, and It was, yeah, that was an incredibly hard time. I still had a few more months left out of my 2 years, and at that time, I wanted to go home so bad and just get back to America where we have better healthcare, hospitals, and get feeling better and get mentally better. But I knew I had to stick through it. I started the 2 year mission and I was going to finish it.
Good job. Yes. So that required a lot of faith to get
through.
Yeah,
definitely.
That was definitely a challenge. Wow. And were you able to stay connected with your family during that time?
A little bit. So as missionaries, we only talk to our families every Monday or only once a week.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah. So that was an added challenge of not even being able to connect with my family like that.
Wow. And during such a crazy time.
Yeah.
That even the hospitals, it was hard to get in anywhere at a certain point. Yeah. So, well, I'm glad you're here and you've got a lot of great work to do. And so now, what are your goals for the next year?
Well, my main goals are to, of course, continue with my podcast, continue to grow my audience and hopefully be able to reach more people and have more amazing opportunities like this one. And then work-wise, I'm actually working to become a police officer right now. And so that's what I'm working towards in this next year. Other than that, not much. Just live life, have fun, and make great experiences.
Oh, that's wonderful. Well, we've got a new police officer in training soon then. That's awesome. Thank you then. That is another guided faith guided kind of a decision to be an officer. Yeah,
it's a hard time, I think, for police officers right now. A lot of people don't trust police officers. A lot of people want to either defund or get rid of police officers. And you know, I think what we need more than anything is really good people with good intentions joining law enforcement and trying to make our community better. And so I hope that I can give my best effort on doing that.
That's wonderful. And if you're listening into this show, I actually had some incredible interviews with other police officers and how they were rebuilding community and relationships and really working on making the police force improved. And so those are some shows that if you go to my YouTube channel, you'll be able to listen there to the past episodes. And so that might be something interesting if you're listening in and interested in that topic. All right. So that's pretty cool. That is, yes, I love that. That is great. Well, I have much respect for you and your goals and your vision. So now, for those listening in, where can they tune into your show?
Yeah, so I have my show on it's on Apple Podcasts, it's on Spotify, it's on all the major podcast networks. It's called the Trey It's called the Trey Kelley Perspective, and so you can look it up anywhere on there. Maybe you could put a link to it on your show.
Yes, I will do that. The Trey Kelley Perspective. And it was kind of cool because the phone like gave music right at the time that you were announcing your show.
was an intro. Yeah.
Intro. So that is really great. And now one of the things that I like to ask is if you could go back in time to your younger self. And I always say around 10 years old, what advice would you give your younger self?
I would love to be able to do that and have some words of wisdom, but I would definitely go back and tell him to be strong, do the little things right every day, because there's a lot of choices that we can make every day. and but there's a few really important choices. They might not seem that big, but they're really important. And if we do those right every day, it really affects the outcome later down the road. And I would really do my best to impress upon him and upon my younger self to make sure to do those little things right and stay consistent and stay disciplined.
Yes, definitely. I agree. Discipline is everything. I totally agree with you there. And such an important thing, because when you're 10, you don't have a lot of discipline.
Yeah, right.
And then there's people that are like 50 and they still don't have discipline.
That's true.
You know, like, you have to force yourself sometimes. But with that, it's like there's form and freedom. If you have the form and the structure to be disciplined, then you own everything. You have the life that you want based on your value system, and you can reach your goals based on what you want in your life. But if you don't have that discipline, you won't have that freedom. So that's it. It's like the key to freedom is discipline. You know, and
yeah,
and
that's perfectly said.
Yeah, a lot
you
of
know, so many people believe.
Yeah, good.
Sorry, so many people believe that, you know, freedom comes from almost the opposite of discipline, from doing whatever you want, whenever you want to do it. When that's not really true, because then you become slave to your emotions, to your desires, whatever you want right in that moment, you have to have it, and you're a slave to that, and that translates to a lot of addictions, like drugs, alcohol, pornography, all these different things. When the true freedom comes from when you are free from your own temptations, your own desires, and you have the discipline to put first things first, and then that will bring you true joy, whatever, and true freedom that you desire in your life.
Yes, that really is true. And you know, you brought up drugs and alcohol and all those different things that are difficult for some people. I have been really blessed with not having that in my life, and my kids don't have that in their life. So like, I don't drink at all, and it's not like a religious thing, or it's just like, that's just my values, and it's a lot of sugar. There's so many reasons, and I like to have my mind, yeah. I like to be in control. Maybe I'm a control freak, because I like to be in control. I don't want like something else to be in control of what I'm thinking or doing. So
exactly.
That's always been my thing, and it's really important. If you have someone out there that is struggling with that, I do have an entire chapter in my book on helping family and friends that might be going through or struggling with an addiction. So that is in my book. And that's something that, you know, if you look around, you might have a friend that's struggling or suffering, and just showing up and being present to support people through their walk out of that is going to be so helpful. And there's ways to do that without, I don't know, maybe helping too much where it's like a crutch and they stay in their addiction. So it's really important. There's ways to do that. And so that's another topic I talk about sometimes, because it's out there and there's a lot of pressure. I mean, you're 21. There's a lot of pressure.
Yeah.
When you go to school, are you in school now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So there's a lot of peer pressure. And even in my age, people are like, let's go to dinner. Let's go drink. And I'm like, I'll have water. I'll have an iced tea. And they're like, why aren't you drinking? I don't need to drink. I'm happy already. I have no need for all that. And
yeah.
So it's one of those things. And so that is discipline. It's self-discipline. And it's dealing with the pressure that comes from the world. And so you have to be really strong in what you've decided and then be disciplined to stick with that.
100%. I love that. And I mean, your content is incredible. I really need to, I'd love to dive more into your content, because just everything that you're saying, it's right on the money in my view.
Oh, well, thank you so much. And I look forward to listening to your show as well. And so we are at the end of our time now. And so I'd like to again share your station or where people can tune in to your show, Trey.
Yes, please. It's the Trey Kelley Perspective at any of the major places where you listen to your podcast.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you again, Trey, for being a special guest on the show. And for those tuning in, we'll be back after these messages. All right. Stay tuned. Okay. One moment. Okay. If you are just tuning in, this is NBC's Sheila Mac Show here on KCAA Radio, the station that leaves no listener behind. I'm your host, Sheila Mac. And today we had a really fun interview. Now, during our interview with Trey, we discovered how his own faith and connections with others helped him to overcome an illness. And then he also battled some depression through that time as well. And so that was something that he had the takeaways. The takeaways, his story was the importance of asking for help when you need it was one of the takeaways that I got that he brought up. And that is important. No matter what age or stage you are in life, there's going to be times where you need to ask for help when you need it. A wonderful point that Trey brought up in our conversation. And now I want to get into a little bit more about the community aspect. Trey talked about he needed support and he reached out and had support with his community. Having an amazing peer group, friends that can guide you and support you and hold you accountable, but also help you when you're down is really important. And, you know, you're gonna go through life and you're gonna find that some people may not be what they say they are or whatever. But you get to know the real ones are the ones that show up when things aren't so good. And that's when you know, oh, those are my people that, you know, they got me, I got them. And like my friends, you call me at 3 a.m. if you're on my friend list. Yeah, we're gonna help each other out. We're gonna have a talk and whatever you need. But that's, you know, that's something that you get to learn about as you go in life. I want to share a little bit about a personal story of how I used my inner guidance, what I call my faith, to make an exciting real estate deal. So if you are listening to this show to get some ideas and you wonder, oh my gosh, can I ever buy anything in this crazy time with inflation and interest rates rising and all this? Is it possible? Are there things out there for starters or to invest in for a first-time investor? What are the possibilities? And there are so many, and I'll be sharing about the different possibilities. So get your pencils out, get your pens out, get your paper out, and get ready to take some notes. Before I delve into my story, I just wanted to introduce myself. You know, I have this show. This is almost my fourth year on the station. And you can also find my show on YouTube and iHeartRadio, as well as KCAA Radio and all the major podcasting channels. So just look for Sheila Mac Show. I am also the author of Bootstraps and Bra Straps. That's the book about life and how to pick yourself up and move forward in life, reinvent yourself, and redesign your life. So it's really going through the different phases of life that we all experience in one form or another, and how to get back on track and reinvent yourself, design your life on your terms. So now the other thing that I have done for 25 plus years is I have also been a real estate agent, a luxury home and relocation strategist. I started out as an investor and later got into helping other people because everybody I knew was like, how do I do that? I want to go invest. And so I ended up helping so many people invest and create wealth that's through property from their first home all the way through getting passive income and really designing their life with generational wealth in mind. And so that is something that I do very well. And it's something I've done for a long time. I have worked with the eXp Realty and then later I transferred. So I also lead courses for real estate agents. on 1031 exchange, which I'll explain if you're like, what's that? I'll explain that a little bit in a minute, and also how to invest for themselves. So if you're a real estate agent and you're listening in, it's really important to also be an investor yourself in properties so that you have some cash flow coming in. This is always a struggle. And right now, real estate's interesting. It's still incredible, but we're going through quite a change and a shift in our commercial world with people working from home now. And so there is a little disruption going on in that realm. And that's another story that we'll talk about on another episode. But getting back to the point, I have been a real estate consultant and coach as well as an agent. I work with Keller Williams Beverly Hills. I help with relocation, and I have a home in Vegas, a home in California. And so I go between the two states and I help people to strategically invest and also to have a vacation home or strategically have their home so that they're able to save a lot on taxes and really enjoy more of a retirement lifestyle and enjoy both worlds like I do. So that is a little bit about me. Personally, I have done the 1031 exchange. I've done 23 of those myself. So if you're wondering what that's about, as you start investing after your home, or maybe you invest, there's so many different ways to do it, and I'll get into all those. But as you invest, let's say you have a duplex or a triplex, and you want to sell it to buy something that's even better with more units and that makes better cash flow. You paid it off or paid it down, and you're ready to reinvest. You don't have to sell and pay capital gains tax as long as you do what's called a 1031 exchange. So at the time of this show, that is still a legal thing to do. And it is within the law. It's like a tax code 1031. And so there's a special process that you need to do. You need to work with an agent that can help you with that. I'm definitely one that has helped many people. Like I said, I've done 23 of my own exchanges plus helped many people. And so when you do that, we work with an accommodator and the agent, and you have a very short time that you need to identify before your sale or during your sale or right after your sale of your property. You need to identify the properties, and you only can identify three properties that you would like to purchase. So it's nice to have an agent that can help you kind of negotiate a deal on the road so that you get to close and not pay the capital gains. And there's ways to do that, but you have 180 days from the time your escrow closes on your sale in order to close escrow on your new buy of one of those three that you've identified, or you lose and you have to pay, you know, like the buzzer goes off and you have to pay a capital gains bill. Now the capital gains tax, it's not like you're not going to pay it. It gets deferred. And so that tax ends up going on to the next sale and the next sale, and eventually they get you. But it's a way to buy up and increase your wealth in real estate strategically without having to lose that capital gains tax. And it's not good if you don't know about it and you're listening in and you have some rental property, even if it's just a unit or two. That's a big deal. And there's certain qualifiers that you have to have the property so long, you have to have rented it out. So there's certain rules that you need to have an agent usually that can help you with all that before you sell. Before you're ready to place it on the market to sell, you want to talk to somebody that knows what they're doing in that realm. I have a team of agents, and I work with other agents across the United States that are all particularly versed in this special 1031 exchange. You can reach out to me, call the Keller office in Beverly Hills, and you can go ahead and ask for Sheila Mac, and I'll be happy to coordinate with you for whatever state you live in and help you to get somebody that can help you with that process. So that's a fun thing when you're ready for that. Now I'm going to tell you a true story about it was kind of like a $35,000 bet. And I don't bet, I don't gamble, but it was a challenge. We're going to call it a challenge because that's a much nicer word. And so it was a challenge. What happened was I do have a nice team of agents that work with me, and I also sometimes will take a newer agent to work with me. They have to qualify, and I did take a new agent on, and she was an incredible agent, and we did a commission split, and I helped walk her through the steps. So when I work with an agent, I'll walk through the steps of how to do each aspect, and we'll do some deals together before they go on their own and start helping people. And so the first commission was a nice commission. We both got $35,000, and that was good for starters. And our bet or our challenge was, okay, now that you have this, because she was just starting out, my challenge to her was, how can you invest this $35,000 so that it starts paying you money? What are you going to do? And so I won that bet or that challenge. And so I hunted, and this was in 2015. So it wasn't that long ago. And I looked and looked, and I actually found a prefabricated, it's almost like a mobile home, but it's a prefabricated. So it's a little different, a better like quality, I guess, as far as the building, the way they build it, it kind of looks like a house. Anyway, I bought a prefabricated home up in the canyons, and that was like the, you know, canyons near Los Angeles. So it's a beautiful area, and the view, there was this huge deck that wrapped around the entire place. It was very private, and you have the view of the entire city. So we're getting close to the 4th of July. We could see fireworks. You could go there and have a party, and everybody could come over and watch the fireworks. So I ended up, well, when it first came on the market, it was like 96 something thousand dollars. And I watched it. And then it went down to 60 something thousand dollars. And at that time, it started to rain in California. And I know we've had a lot of rain last year, but usually it doesn't rain that much in California. And so nobody wanted to drive up the canyon in the rain. And it was raining. So it was like, oh, good. Nobody's going to go look at that place. And so I waited. And then they dropped the price again to $39,000. And I drove up that canyon. I was like, okay, drive up the canyon. Cool. And I offered cash, $35,000 as is. I did bring a contractor friend with me. And so we met the listing agent, and I got the deal. It didn't need a lot of, it needed paint. It needed a little work. And I did put a couple of walls up, and they have different permitting rules, the prefab houses, than a regular house, let's just say. And so you don't have to do as much with the permitting, which was even better. And I just put up two walls. They were to code, they were safety and this and that. And I spent about $4,500 to do that. I put that on my credit card to prove I was going to stay kind of in my limit. And I painted, I helped with the drywall. I put my own, I will roll up my sleeves and do the work when it's necessary because I was on a challenge. So I made it a game. And if you like Tony Robbins, he has a book, Money Master the Game. So it is a game. And so I made it a game, and I made it into three units. There was enough bathrooms, showers for everybody, the way I separated the houses up. And I added little, like a little kitchenette, and made it really cute. I designed it so it was kind of like Zen. I called it the yoga deck, and I had yoga mats, and I had like the little statues and little cute little things that everybody likes, and I made it beautiful. Okay, the furniture, I did buy the furniture too, and I spent about under $1,000 literally, and I bought all the furniture, the beds, new mattresses, and I got it from, okay, you got your notes out. I got it from what they call Habitat for Humanity Restore. And what I love about that place is that you actually are donating back to Habitat for Humanity that helps people that need homes get homes. And so many people donate their used or pre-owned furniture. A lot of times furniture stores will donate furniture they didn't sell to get a write-off. And so most of the furniture I got came out of like mansions. I had artwork from some famous people's homes that they had just picked up and brought over to the store. So it was really beautiful and for pennies. So check out Habitat for Humanity. You'll be helping somebody get a home and you'll get some really good deals. If you're a contractor or you're remodeling your house, go there first. It took me, I did some of the work because I wanted to move the project along. Now that's something you have to think about. If you don't know how to do this, I've done this kind of stuff many, many times. And so it was a fun challenge for me. I would go to Home Depot and I would get the list of what the contractors needed the day before in the evening. And they stay open late in California. And so I would go ahead. They would give me a list of everything to buy. I'd buy everything on the list, pull up in my van. And then in the morning, I would have like breakfast for the guys, for the workers. And we were all friends. And because I give them lots of other work with other remodels or maybe staging a house or whatever as a real estate agent. So they gave me a very fair price and I did that work. Well, let me tell you, that cuts your budget like by a third. And so negotiate your price, get it in writing, and then whatever, if you can do that kind of work, they're not shopping. I always gave them breakfast. I always gave them like nice, so they could just show up and not have to like go get food and they could just work. And it was great because they were happy and I was happy and it worked out for all of us. And I got the job done like a month and a half. I was pretty much under 2 months, let's just say, I was done and ready to go. And I became the super host with a popular vacation rental platform. And I don't want to say the name, but you can guess. And so it was, I also wrote a beautiful write-up about, I called it the View Home Nature Retreat. And I've had people have their honeymoon at my mobile prefab home. And I've had people that were repeat, they would come over and they would vacation in California and that's where they would stay. My prices were very fair. And I also rented to corporate many times to like traveling nurses and corporate because they stayed longer. And so that made it easier to maintain, kept the price point down. I had hired cleaning service to help. And sometimes I clean stuff up, you know, or whatever needed to be done because you need to do that. Well, I was making $6,000 to $8,000 a month off my $35,000, well, you know, a little bit more than that investment. I paid off the credit cards the first month. I paid everything off. And then it was all positive cash flow. The land lease was like $1,000 a month. So take that off. Still made a great deal. Later sold that for $295. 3.5 years later when they changed the rules and I was no longer legally able to have the vacation rental there. And then it wouldn't really pencil for me to keep it. And then what did I do? 1031 exchange to the next property. And so that is, everything is possible. So if you're thinking it is impossible now, and yeah, that was a different time, but I've done this in all kinds of times. And so it is possible. I can promise you that. You need to work with an agent that can help you with those kind of things. If you're a first time or new investor, I have great referrals. If you look on the Sheila Mac Show on YouTube, I just reshared an interview I did with a mortgage broker that's great, helps in every state in the US and gets the first time home buyer all the deals. And so a good agent will help you get the resources you need to get started and work with you through your process to prepare for your investment or your first time home, and then help you if you're at a different stage in your life where you're looking for a luxury home, or you're going to go ahead and get a vacation home and strategically retire and have fun. So there's many things that can be done. And each episode, I am going to, at least the second half of the show or sometime in the show, I'm going to share some of these tips and stories, real life stories and tips about ways for you to get started or to have success in investing in property for profits. And so that is something that I'm happy to help you with. And again, you can reach out to the Keller Williams Beverly Hills office, or you can go to my website, SheilaMac.com. It is working now, but I'm having a new site built. But it is there, and you can still contact me that way as well. So that is it for today. I hope you took some good notes on how to get started. And my little fun challenge, I did win that bet, and we had fun with it. So there's lots of different fun things you can do. I hope you tune in next time. And again, you can listen to older episodes on YouTube at Sheila Mac Show. And also you can go to kcaaradio.com, and there you can also listen to some of the other shows that I've had and get lots of advice that way. So I hope you tune in again. And I wish you life, love, laughter, and light. Again, remember, you can go to SheilaMac.com. I do have a mastermind class for real estate agents. And I also have a mastermind class for those that are first-time home buyers. And I also have a link that I'll share on my YouTube under this show about how to do consulting if you just want like a strategic plan for how you can invest or strategically either buy your first home or invest in properties for retirement, for a vacation home, and make it strategic so that you save lots of money. All right. All right. See you next time.
Tune in again right here on KCAA, the station that leaves no listener behind.
KCAA Loma Linda. The legacy KCAA 1050 AM and Express 106.5 FM.
NBC News Radio, I'm Lisa Taylor. Delays and cancellations continue to pile up at airports in the Northeast. According to FlightAware, over 4,500 flights have been delayed within, into, or out of the U.S. so far today. Meantime, over 1,400 flights have been canceled across the country. Former President Trump is rallying New Hampshire voters for his 2024 White House bid.
On November 5th, 2024, we're going to stand up to the Marxists and communists, fascists and globalists. We're going to evict crooked Joe Biden. He is crooked as hell.
He spent much of his speech railing against President Biden's domestic and foreign policies. Polling shows Trump well ahead of other Republicans running for president. Attorney General Merrick Garland is set to testify before the House later this summer. Although it's a regularly scheduled hearing with a House Judiciary Committee, it comes as some Republicans call for his impeachment following whistleblower testimony. Speaker McCarthy recently suggested the House could launch an impeachment inquiry over IRS whistleblower allegations the Justice Department interfered in the Hunter Biden investigation. The in-laws and nephew of NASCAR legend Jimmy Johnson have been killed in an apparent double murder-suicide. Jack Cronin has the update.
Police in Oklahoma are investigating the deaths of Jack and Terry Janway and their 11-year-old grandson Dalton as a double murder-suicide. Police think Terry shot and killed her husband and grandson, then killed herself, but they don't have a motive. TMZ says the couple are the in-laws of El Cajon native and NASCAR legend Jimmy Johnson, who's pulled out of this weekend's race.
Angela Bassett is among this year's batch of honorary Oscar winners.
I am queen of the most powerful nation in the world, and my entire family is gone. Have I not given everything?
The Academy said they decided to award Bassett because her performances set a new standard in acting. The actress has only been nominated two times, once for her portrayal of Tina Turner in What's Love Got to Do with It, and as Queen Ramonda in Black Panther: Wakanda Forever. You're listening to the latest on NBC News Radio.
If I could escape, I would, but first of all, let me say I must be 10-year slate of famous names being suggested for stars on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. Members of the Walk of Fame class of 2023 do not automatically get a star. They must schedule a ceremony within 2 years to get the honor. Among the list of 31 names announced this week are Gwen Stefani, Eugene Levy, Kerry Washington, Billie Jean King, Jim Nance, Carl Weathers, and Sammy Hagar. There are also posthumous nominations, which include Chadwick Boseman and Otis Redding.
You're just too good to be true.
Singer Frankie Valli is a married man at the age of 89. Valli tied the knot in Las Vegas this week. His new wife is 60-year-old Jackie Jacobs, a former CBS executive. People magazine reports it was a private ceremony, and Valli sang Can't Take My Eyes Off of You to his new bride.
Do you get deja vu when she's with you?
Olivia Rodrigo announcing a release date for her second album titled Guts. The three-time Grammy winner said the album's about growing pains and discovering who she is. Fans have been anticipating new music since her first album, Sour, dropped in May of 2021. The new album set to be released September 8th. And Angela Bassett will be an honorary Oscar winner. The Academy said it decided to award Bassett because her performances set a new standard in acting. The star only nominated two times, once for her portrayal of Tina Turner in What's Love Got to Do with It, and as Queen Ramonda in Black Panther, Wakanda Forever. That's entertainment. I'm Liz Warner, NBC News Radio.
This segment sponsored by the generous support of the Dream Team. Looking for the keys to something bigger and better? Downsizing or relocating to the perfect spot? Oscar Ramirez from Century 21 Lois Lauer Real Estate and Matt Flores from Secure Choice Lending.